Hello, this is Pauline Jennings. Welcome to Musician Talk. My guest today is Pete Schlief. Pete is currently in his 26th year of teaching vocal music. He has directed school, church, and community choirs in Colorado, North Dakota, and Minnesota. Choirs under his direction have performed all over the United States and internationally. Pete received a Bachelor of Arts degree from Concordia College in Moorhead, Minnesota, where he studied with René Clausen. In addition to his role as director of the vocal performance program at Shattuck-St. Mary's, he is also the associate conductor of Cantanti, a community choir based in Northfield, Minnesota. He lives in Northfield with his wife, Lori, and two sons, Isaac and Ian. Well, it's time to learn more. Let's talk to Pete Schlief. Hi, Pete. How are you doing?
I'm good, thank you.
Oh, good. Nice to see you on Zoom. How have you been holding up since March?
We've been holding up okay. You know, like everybody, a little bit stir crazy. Like everybody, kind of trying to find new and creative ways to stay busy. Mostly trying to make sure my kids stay busy with various activities, from a little bit of baseball to radio dramas, and trying to make sure that they're good and active.
How many kids do you have?
I have two sons. So Isaac is just turned 13 yesterday, actually, and his little brother Ian is 10.
Wonderful. And I know Isaac because he did radio plays with me.
Yeah.
And what a stellar performer you have, and playing piano too. He is incredible. I'm assuming that your 10-year-old probably is the same.
We try to keep him busy musically.
That's good. That's great. Before the school year started, how'd you keep yourself busy musically?
Musically, I spent the summer learning a lot of tech skills, actually, which is, you know, not really what you sign up for as a music educator, but kind of the advent of virtual choirs and just knowing that I was going to be teaching virtually, getting used to some of the technology as far as video and audio editing, kind of upping the ante as far as the equipment to have at home and learning how to use it. That's actually been a big focus for me musically this summer. It's not necessarily a musical skill, but it is a way that I can continue, hopefully, being an effective teacher from a distance.
No kidding. So many teachers have had to do that. They didn't sign up for that as a teacher. And here you are learning all these new skills. Not that that's not a good thing to learn these new skills, and it probably will help in other ways.
I hope so. I'm a bit of an optimist, maybe too much so sometimes. And so kind of thinking about how are these skills going to be used once we're on the other side of all of this, and how will that enhance our lives musically? How will that be good for students? How will just that be good for the musical world going forward? So yeah, trying to find that silver lining of what can we do going forward that's going to make this better. From an accessibility standpoint, I mean, I can see this really being great for kids that maybe don't have access to the best teachers or geographically aren't as close to those teachers.
Well, and I think it will. I think that everybody's learning a new way here, that we may dispose of some of it, but moving forward, even after COVID, I think some of these skills and ways of teaching will be integrated into how we move forward.
Absolutely.
I want to take you back to when you were a child. Now you're a conductor and a director of choirs. You are a singer and you're a piano player. So do you remember how old you were when you started singing?
The first time I took singing seriously was probably not until 9th or 10th grade.
Okay.
I think like every kid, you know, I was singing and my parents dragged me along to church choir when I was in like 5th grade. And so I was, there was an element of it that was around me, but the first time I really took it seriously was probably high school.
And how did you take it seriously? Did you join the choir?
I joined the choir. So I grew up in Owatonna down the road, and I went to the Catholic school there in town from kindergarten through 8th grade. And so 9th grade was kind of my first year going to the big public school. And the choir program in Owatonna then and today was absolutely remarkable. I mean, everyone in the school tried out for the choir. It was a school of about 1,300 at the time, and probably 700 or 800 kids were trying out for the many, many choirs that they had there.
Wow.
So it was just kind of something that you did, right? It didn't matter what stupid clique you were in or you know, whatever label was put on you or you put on yourself. Everyone was in choir. And we had a teacher that was just incredibly inspiring. He was actually the first national teacher of the year who was a music teacher in 1967.
That's
so cool. Just a really inspiring really inspiring guy. So that's when I found out I was okay at it. It was just what everybody was doing.
It's interesting that you say that it didn't matter what clique you were in, because in high school, of course, that's such a, unfortunately, an important part of kids' lives. And did you find that being in the choir and singing with these kids from other cliques, let's just say, broke down some of those walls?
Absolutely. I think that's led directly to my teaching philosophy and kind of my take on music in general, is that it's all about connections and it's all about crossing those boundaries and maybe breaking down some of those stereotypes from jock to nerd to theater geek to all of those things. I mean, singing together is one way that you can break down a lot of those barriers.
That's beautiful. So when did you start playing piano?
I started playing piano when I was 5, and that was just an assumption in my family that you started out taking piano lessons. My teacher was Portia Johnson. I took lessons from her until probably 5th or 6th grade, and that's when school band started up, and I started playing the trombone, and I somehow talked my mom into the fact that I was way too busy, and I couldn't keep up both trombone and piano, which is a load of crap. I could have easily done both of them. but I somehow talked my mom into it, and so she let me stop taking piano lessons and concentrate on trombone, which I'm sure, you know, there's so many of us out there that say, if I could go back and change one thing, it would be that. That's why my boys are taking piano, and that's why they'll continue taking piano. I mean, it leads to so many other things that, you know, it's almost like learning how to read, right? Like if you learn how to read, you can read any book in the whole wide world. If you know how to play the piano, you can do so many other instruments easily. You can do a little bit more music theory. You can do a little bit more improv. Your jazz skills are going to get better. Like so much of it comes from keyboard skills.
Piano is a percussive and a melodic instrument.
Yep.
It does. It helps you in every single instrument you're ever going to pick up in your life.
Yep.
So you were playing trombone, you stopped playing piano, then what happened?
I really fell in love with the trombone as well, and continued playing all through high school. I was able to continue my musical studies with trombone lessons and playing in the band and orchestra, and then also singing. High school is really where I started taking on a little bit more leadership roles and really fell in love with choral music, with just singing as a group. And that's, I think, where the seed really got planted in me that maybe I wanted to be a choir director.
Did you do any directing in high school?
I did. They had there's a Christmas caroler group that still exists in Owatonna that's student led, and they choose a student director every year. And so when I was a junior in high school, I got lucky enough to be chosen to be that student director, and I took it pretty seriously.
You decided to go to college for singing and vocal directing and trombone?
Gave up the trombone when I went to school. So I ended up going up to Concordia College in Moorhead, primarily because René Clausen was the choir director there. And he had directed a Big Nine all-conference choir that I was in, a student, and I just knew that I wanted to study with him. I knew that I wanted to be in his choir. I knew that I wanted to study conducting with him. And so I went up to Concordia as a music education major with a vocal music emphasis.
So you started directing a small group when you were a junior. When you went to college then, and through your college career, did you start directing more and more, conducting more and more?
I did. I actually landed a church choir directing job while I was an undergraduate, which was great, kind of baptism by fire, right? Like I really didn't know what I was doing, but now I was getting paid for it, and I had to kind of step up to the plate. So that was a great experience for me. I kind of worked my way up through some larger churches and really kind of learned a little bit more about liturgical music and kind of the church music side of things as well.
So you graduated, and then where'd you go?
I landed a job in a little town called Lamar in the southeast corner of Colorado, and taught there for 2 years, and nobody really cared what I did. Nobody was looking over my shoulder. The administrators didn't care. And looking back, that was one of the greatest things that could have happened to me. I had freedom to program what I wanted to program. I had freedom to teach the way that I wanted to teach, sing any of the music that I wanted to sing. That's had a really strong impact on the rest of my career.
In what way would you say that affected the rest of your career?
I think, you know, we're all kind of a combination of our teachers, right? And so I've had the good fortune of having these amazing mentors in my life. And, you know, to kind of pick and choose the best of all of them and then add a little bit of myself. The fact that I was alone and single and bored and no one cared what I was doing meant that I could kind of distill that into a couple of years' time. And I think I had a lot of growth in a short period of time.
Wow, what a blessing. So where did you go from Colorado?
You know, Minnesota calls people back. I landed a job in Eagan in District 196, teaching at one of the middle schools there. And then a friend of a friend contacted me and said there's an opening at St. Anthony Village High School. St. Anthony Village is on the northeast side of Minneapolis. And it was a middle school and high school choral job. Spent about 8 years teaching there. Teaching in what was essentially an urban school district was a really, really wonderful experience. And one of the longer jobs that I've had as well. I stayed there for a good long time.
And so bring us up to date. What are you doing now? Where are you teaching? Where are you conducting? Where are you directing?
I'm currently the director of the vocal performance program at Shattuck-St. Mary's boarding school in Faribault. And I'm the associate director of E Cantanti Chamber Choir here in Northfield. So I have to take a step back to explain what this program is at Shattuck.
Yes.
Shattuck has 9 centers of excellence, or COEs, and it's essentially students declaring a major while they're in high school. It's an emphasis for their high school career. And obviously Shattuck is known for its hockey program, some of its other athletics, its soccer program, and figure skating and golf. But we also have centers of excellence in vocal music, instrumental music, bioscience, and mechanical engineering. So I have a small program of students who are incredibly passionate about vocal music. So I oversee a program that provides private voice, private piano, a choir experience, college level music theory. My students sing in a lot of competitions around the country. The opportunity at Shattuck came up at just the right time. It was a little bit more of an administrative role. I had a little bit more control over a program that I could craft into what I thought was best for students. So that's been a wonderful challenge. Leaving the public schools and going to a boarding school, a private boarding school, has been a shift. It's been a very steep learning curve, and it's been a wonderful, wonderful change. We have students from 36 different countries, all 50 states. When COVID hit in the middle of March, I was coordinating students learning from 7 different time zones. So we were trying to coordinate all of this from a distance, and it was a fascinating and wonderful puzzle to try to figure out.
I love your positive attitude. That's great. That takes us back to that wonderful idea of breaking down walls. You know, here you have these students from all over the world getting together and singing together, and what better way you learn about each other's humanity.
One of the other barriers that we can break down is that Shattuck-St. Mary's is filled with incredibly wealthy kids, and that's not necessarily the case. We have there's diversity in our economic status as well, and so that adds another layer to all of this. So, I mean, it is an incredibly diverse gem of a community right down the road.
Wow. Okay, so I want to move on to the first song because we need to. I'd love to keep talking about this a lot more. But this first song is called Kresnich, and it's a Slovenian folk song, and it's the Winona Senior High Concert Choir. Did you teach there for a while too?
I did, yeah. So the gap in some of the conversation earlier was a 4-year stint down at Winona, teaching, directing just their concert choir. And this was kind of the first time that I had a large concert choir, right? You think of Minnesota choirs and you think of these big 60 to 80 voice mixed choirs. And this was the first time I had a big choir. And so we had the opportunity to do some literature that hadn't been in the past. I was also the repertoire and standards chair for ethnic and multicultural music for the State Choral Directors Association at the time. So I was really immersing myself in non-Western music in trying to find some music from a lot of different places. And Kresnich popped up, and it's just a wonderful, simple little folk song that has two groups of girls chasing each other and kind of chasing each other from house to house and wishing people a good harvest. It's usually sung in the fall, which is part of why I picked it for the show, since we're in the fall now. When you listen to it, it's really fascinating to hear. There's actually two groups of singers, and they're in two different time signatures and two different tempi. So they're singing at different speeds and with a different meter signal. So that's the chasing part. You'll hear the dee da dee da, and then the other one will kind of interrupt them. Ba-da-da-ba-ba-da-da-da. So, and that just keeps going. They just keep overlapping.
Very cool. Well, I think that sets it up perfectly. Let's listen to Krasnichi sung by the Winona Senior High Concert Choir in 2004. It's a live recording. Let's listen. This is Musician Talk, hosted by me, Pauline Jennings, and you just heard Krasnich, a Slovenian folk song sung by the Winona Senior High Concert Choir in 2004, directed by my guest, Pete Schlief. What I do hear when I hear this song is a very cohesive group. It's beautiful.
It was a great situation at the time because that choir rehearsed for 90 minutes, 5 days a week. In a high school, which is just unheard of. They're not on that schedule anymore. But at the time that I was there, we had almost as much rehearsal time per week as the St. Olaf Choir does, or as the Concordia Choir does, right? These massive chunks of time to really come together as a group musically, to come together as a group socially. And that particular choir was over 100 in the choir as well. So it was a huge group of kids.
Wow. And how do you approach directing differently for a group that size compared to what you said, like the chamber groups?
Generally, chamber groups are a little bit more auditioned, right? So the level of ability coming in is a little bit higher, right? So you might take your big group of kids and audition it down to the best 16. But when you've got a group of 100, you're going to have a bigger spectrum of abilities. And so you learn to kind of shelter your language in a way that speaks to a broader group of learners. So I think you change things that way. You can also hide some sins in a larger group. If there's a kid that is a little bit off key in a group of 100, you're probably not going to notice. In a group of 16, you might notice.
How do you pick your songs? How do you program?
Wow. There's no short answer to that. There's a really, really long list of things that we go through. It depends on the group, right? It depends on the ability level of the group. It depends on what the group has sung in the past. It depends on kind of what direction you want the group to go towards. A rule for me is variety and diversity, especially with kind of the cultural awakening that we've all been going through this summer. Is just personally, I've been trying to put more emphasis on underrepresented composers. So trying to balance out the dead white guys with a little bit more contemporary literature, because there's some really, really great choral music being written right now by contemporaries, and we have this opportunity to actually connect with them, right? To actually, we have composers zoom in on rehearsals because we can, right? Because we're all stuck at home and they're available. So the poetry, the lyrical quality of things has to be of high quality. I put a high priority on that. The compositional style has to be both musical and academically sound, meaning there are pedagogical things that I can teach my choir via this melody or via this piece of music, right? If I need them to work on keeping a better sense of pulse, I'm going to choose a piece of music that's a little bit more strictly rhythmic. If I want them to work on a more musical line, being a little bit more melodic, I'm going to choose a different tune. So, you know, there's kind of these categories that we try to make sure we meet throughout the course of a school year. Yeah, I think by the time they leave me for graduation or they stop being in choir, whatever the case may be, I want to make sure that they've been exposed to a broad variety of choral music. And that's a really general answer to a very specific question. It's really difficult, right? There's so much amazing music out there from the past. There's so much amazing music out there from the present. There's so much amazing music out there from different parts of the world. So you have to take all of that and combine it with the ability of the choir and what they've done in the past and what you want them to do in the future. So most of us, I think I can speak for the bulk of the choir world, we spend the most time sitting with music, trying to decide which of those pieces is going to be best for our choir that year.
That's wonderful. Thank you. That was really, really instructive to me because I had no idea that there was so much involved. How do you prepare to conduct a piece?
There's a couple different layers to that onion. The first thing I do is I go through the score. I go through the music and I mark it. We have a color-coded system of when entrances are and where the melodic line is or where the difficult parts might be, where we're going to really need to rehearse. And so there's kind of a elaborate shorthand. So that's the first step, is score study. And then I sing through each individual line. In a good year, I'll have it all memorized. That's not always the case, but I'll learn every line so that in rehearsal, I can say, oh, altos, it goes like this, you know, and I've got it on the top of my head and I'm not thinking about it. This is all before the first rehearsal even happens. The last step is a ton of time actually directing in front of a mirror. So sitting with a recording and the score in front of me and actually staring at myself and how do I look and what's my gesture going to look like. And this is for each tune. So it's probably, I don't know, 10 to 12 hours per piece of music of prep. Then you kind of start drawing out a rehearsal plan. Like, this is what we're going to do in the first rehearsal. This is probably where they'll screw up. This is where we'll try to fix this or that. And then off you go.
That's fascinating. You know, one of the things that I find most amazing about choir teachers is that you can sing every part, because just getting one harmony line is a little difficult sometimes. Although I grew up as an alto, so I should be able to. What's your biggest challenge as a director?
Trying to find that way to connect every kid to every piece is probably the biggest challenge. And frankly, probably one that I rarely hit the mark on. But that's the goal, is to get every kid personally invested in what we're doing.
And the follow-up to that, of course, on the other side of challenge, is what comes easiest to you? And that it can also be connected to what's your favorite part about being a choir director?
Right. I think it's the little interactions with kids. The relationship that's built between a student and a trusted adult, that connection is one that I cherish and one that I'm inspired by. I think it's those kind of micro interactions that you have with each kid that's the best part of the job.
And maybe I should audition for E Cantanti, because it sounds like you're a choir director I'd like to sing for. I just created a great transition to this next song, because this next song is performed by E Cantanti. You're an associate director for that choir?
Yep.
Yes. So tell me a little bit about this song. It is called
In Dulci Jubilo. So most people will recognize the tune. It's a pretty traditional Christmas carol. Bum bum ba da 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 dum. But this is a relatively new, I think it's a 5-year-old rendition of this, written by Minnesota composer Matthew Culleton, who's the director of The Singers, which is a professional ensemble based out of Minneapolis. And Michael wrote this and put this really kind of cool vamp down at the bottom. So you'll hear some of the lower voices singing Dulci Jubilo, Dulci Jubilo. And it's just got this really cool kind of driving rhythmic aspect to it that really kind of lets the melody just pop.
Excellent. Let's take a listen to In Dulci Jubilo, sung by E Cantanti and directed by my guest, Peter Schleif.
Dulci Jubilo, Dulci Jubilo.
This is Pauline Jennings, and you're listening to Musician Talk. My guest today is Pete Schlief. You just heard the I Cantanti Chamber Choir, directed by Pete, singing In Dulci Jubilo, recorded live in 2019.
Another beautiful, beautiful song. Everything's so melded, although, and this is what I love about it, you can hear everything distinctly. Everything has its place. Nicely done.
I'm very grateful that Wayne Kibble asked me to come on as associate director a few years ago. I mean, he's built this choir up over the last 33 years, and it's really, truly a great asset to this community. Yeah. I hope people realize that not every town our size has an adult community choir of this quality. That's when I get to drive a Cadillac with I Cantanti, and I'm very, very grateful for that.
How many people are in I Cantanti?
I think we've got 36 singers on the roster right now.
Oh, what a nice size.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. I've been so inspired by them throughout these times. These people love singing and they need it. They need to sing. And even though we can't sing together in the same space right now, we're setting up some Zoom rehearsals where they'll be able to sing from their own living room and keep that connection going, even though they're separated. In our last Zoom meeting, we kind of pulled them and said, do you want to keep rehearsing even though it's over Zoom? And overwhelmingly, they all said, yes, we just want to sing. So that's really been a joy.
What is that drive? Why do we need to, as musicians, play? What does it bring to our lives that we're looking for?
Wow. I do truly believe that it all comes back to relationships. I do truly believe that music draws us together. Performing music, listening to music, talking about music, studying music, it doesn't matter, right? It doesn't matter if you're a trained musician or someone that just likes to rock every once in a while. It's a connection between you and the performer. It's a connection between you and the songwriter. It's a connection between you and the other person that's listening to it at the same time. It's about these connections. This connectivity is what keeps us going, what keeps us searching for more, keeps us creating. I think it drives just about everything in the music world.
Those great moments that you've had with music brings me to best gig, worst gig, but we're going to start with worst gig. Now, this has been mostly people performing. They've had bad experiences performing themselves, but I'm interested in getting the director's take and what could go bad.
Can I give you two worst gigs?
Absolutely.
The rock band that I played in high school was called Straight Ace, and we were pretty great. It was mostly Zeppelin and Floyd covers and, you know, some kind of arena rock in there and some what I'm guessing are really, really bad originals. And we got to play at the after prom at the Owatonna Junior High.
Oh, exciting.
And that was like our one big gig for the year. And honestly, I forgot the lyrics to probably 3/4 of the song that we sang that night. And I was just mumbling along the entire time, but it was loud and I was proud. So that's probably one of them. Another one was actually with the Winona High School Choir that we heard a recording of earlier. We had a concert at a church in Mankato. And it was in early May, but it was one of those really, really hot, like 90 degree early May days. And this choir wore heavy black robes.
Oh no.
You can see where I'm going with this.
Yeah.
I knew that it was going to happen. And so I had some administrators and some fellow teachers of mine sitting in the front pew of this church. And I had instructed them, when I point, you run. And sure enough, about halfway through the first song, a little soprano starts passing out. By the end of our half hour set, we had 9 kids who had either passed out or come close to passing out. Oh, and they were all sitting in the pew. And these teachers had just kept coming up. I'm just pointing while I'm directing. There's another one. There's another one. There's another one. Because we knew it was going to happen and we just had to kind of plow through it. So worst gig or maybe one of the most amazing ones. I don't know.
Oh boy. But it's nice that you at least had it set up so that you could take care of it.
Right. Well, and you're worried, like, is the kid going to be okay?
Right, of course.
So we joked about it later.
Good, good, good. And that's, you know, when bad things happen, that's the good part about it is you have a story. Okay, best gig. I bet you've had a ton of really great gigs with your students.
I have, and with I Cantanti as well. You know, okay, I took a choir, this was when I was teaching in St. Anthony Village, and I took a choir to Finland, and we toured around Finland and Sweden and Estonia for a couple of weeks. And One of our first concerts in Finland. They had an entire hour and a half long set of music, entirely a cappella. It was a group of just 16 singers, and so it was a difficult program. And we started singing, and we sang a big rousing opener, and I cut them off, and it was silent.
Oh.
And I didn't know what to do. And so I just kind of moved to the next song, and we got done with that one. Nothing. And it was silent. And we went through an entire hour and a half program, and it was completely silent. And then the last song we got done, it was a pretty rousing rhythmic tune, and that last cut off, and the audience erupted and jumped to their feet and applauded for what seemed like several minutes. And our native guide came up to me afterwards, and she could tell that I was disturbed, right? She could tell that I was jarred by all of this. And she said, that's the greatest sign of respect that audience can show, is not interrupting your program.
Okay, so, you just gave me chills.
Traditionally in Finland, you don't applaud until the very end. So then just that realization, like, oh, they really loved it.
Wow.
And the connection that the kids felt then to the audience afterwards, it was just a wonderful moment of learning and great music, and kind of a cultural exchange that we didn't know was going to happen.
Right.
That's probably up there.
Yeah, it sounds like it. They not only liked it, they honored it. You can't get much higher praise than that. That's a great story. And we're out of time, so that's perfect. And what a great conversation. I've learned a lot today. I really have learned a lot.
And well, so, I really appreciate you thinking of me. Thank you.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much to Pete Schlief for joining me today for this terrific conversation. And so many, many thanks to you out there for listening and tuning in to Musician Talk on the 1 95.1 KYMN.